You're watching Tag TV.
Hello viewers, I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show. Quad is no more just a virtual grouping or what was being perceived as a paper tiger by Chinese media. The first in-person meeting of Quad leaders in the United States last week has laid out a clear framework vis-a-vis order and operations in the Indo-Pacific. All of them have signaled and integrated for a free Indo-Pacific. Unsettled by these developments, Beijing has resorted to its rhetoric, calling it a conspiracy to contain Chinese growth.
With pledges of solidarity, cooperation in fighting the COVID-19, and a commitment to push for integrated infrastructure building and technology, the Quad countries have held their first in-person Quad meeting that has been dubbed as an obstacle to Chinese expansionism by experts. All of them stress the importance of a free and open Indo-Pacific, while India's Prime Minister Narendra Modi also called for peace in the Indo-Pacific. Modi also underscored that grouping will be taking to supply a billion COVID-19 shots across Asia by the end of 2022, an initiative agreed at a virtual Quad summit in March.
या वैश्विक सुरक्षा हो, क्लाइमेट एक्शन हो या कोविड रिस्पॉन्स या फिर टेक्नोलॉजी में सहयोग, इन सभी विषयों पर मुझे अपने साथियों से चर्चा करते बहुत खुशी होगी. हमारा क्वाड एक तरह से फोर्स फॉर ग्लोबल गुड की भूमिका में काम करेगा. मुझे विश्वास है क्वाड में हमारा सहयोग इंडो-पैसिफिक में और विश्व में शांति और समृद्धि सुनिश्चित करेगा.
India, which had supplied millions of vaccines earlier in the year, had to immediately halt its export owing to a sudden rise in domestic infection rate. However, it has announced that it will resume the export in a few weeks. US President Biden, who also urged for a united response to anything that was challenging the freedom of Indo-Pacific, thanked India for its decision.
In sum, we are four major democracies with a long history of cooperation. We know how to get things done, and we are up to the challenge. And I'm looking forward to our discussion today, and I thank you. And now I yield to my friend from India.
The meeting came just over a week after the United States, Britain, and Australia announced an AUKUS security pact under which Australia will be provided with nuclear-powered submarines, a move that has been roundly denounced by Beijing. Morrison further stated the Indo-Pacific should be free from coercion, addressing a concern about Beijing's increasing assertiveness and growing influence in the region.
So we stand here together in the Indo-Pacific region, a region that we wish to be always free from coercion, where the sovereign rights of all nations are respected, and where disputes are settled peacefully in accordance with international law.
Apart from the vaccine efforts, the Quad is also united at bolstering supply chain security for semiconductors, combating illegal fishing, and boosting maritime domain awareness. It will also roll out a 5G partnership and plans for monitoring climate change. The Quad developments, however, have created ripples in Beijing power corridors, which have urged the grouping to not target any third country and its interests. China calls itself a builder of world peace, contributor of global development, and upholder of world order. However, not many, or to say it precisely, not even a few states acknowledge or support its stance.
moving on. Today, if the human rights violations had a face, it would be a fusion of the Pakistani Prime Minister Imran Khan and his Army General Qamar Javed Bajwa. Pakistani leaders have resorted to brutality to not just rein in those who do not fall in line, but have used it as their primary tool to suppress and eliminate those whom they don't identify as similar to themselves. Whether it is Kashmiris, Balochs, Sindhis or Pashtuns, the successive Punjabi dominant dispensations have meted out similar atrocities on all. However, they are relentless in their demands and say they will not give up until their rights are restored. Recently, European cities of London and Geneva saw people of these origins holding anti-PAK demonstrations and urging the world to cut off ties with Pakistan.
A large number of Kashmiri activists gathered in London last week to protest the visit of Pakistani Foreign Minister Shah Mahmood Qureshi. While highlighting Islamabad's state policy of nurturing and spreading terrorism in Kashmir and the region around Pakistan, they urged the UK leadership to corner Pakistan on the subject.
Stop terrorism in Kashmir, in Kashmir!
Activists accused Pakistan of using terrorists to carry out ethnic genocide in Pakistan-occupied Kashmir and said over 500,000 Kashmiris were systematically killed by the state in the past 7 decades.
Protest jo humne yahan arrange kiya hai iska bunyadi maqsad ye hai ke Pakistan ke foreign minister Shah Mahmood Qureshi sahab yahan tashreef la rahe hain hum unse ye mutalba karte hain ke ye jo dehshatgardi humne aapne phailayi hai andar maqbooza Kashmir mein ये खत्म की जाए इसलिए कि ये 70 ईयर से दहशतगर्दी जारी है और कश्मीरी मारे जा रहे हैं कश्मीरी उसी तरह मार रहे हैं कर्फ्यू लगा हुआ है इनके वजीर आजम साहब अक्वामे मुतिदा में गए उन्होंने तकरीर की है वापस आकर वो भी सो गए क्योंकि कश्मीरी का नाक खून जो कत्ले रेजी हो रही है पाकिस्तानी एजेंसियों की तरफ से हम इंटरनेशनल कम्युनिटी से पुरजोर मुतालबा करते हैं कि इसको अक्वामे मुतिदा में जरूर पेश किया जाए कि पाकिस्तान जो दहशतगर्दी वहां करवा रहा है अंदर मकबूजा कश्मीर में और हमारे बेगुनाह कश्मीरियों को मरवाया जा रहा है 500,000 कश्मीरी जो है वो किल्ड बाय द पाकिस्तानी एजेंसीज
Pakistan, which continues to find itself in the grey list of the Financial Action Task Force, has earned the reputation of a terror state in the past few decades. Its nefarious agenda was recently exposed in its western neighbor Afghanistan, where it provided active military support to the Taliban to topple a democratically elected government. Activists alleged that Islamabad had similar ambitions of installing a terrorist government in Kashmir by altering the region's demography. Kashmiri said, while the number of terror camps and launch pads has exponentially increased in the region in the past few years, rights activists are being imprisoned, tortured and killed.
We all stand for peace, democracy, secularism and social justice. And these are the values Pakistani state is against. So, we request Pakistan to change their policies of terrorism. Pakistan is an international hub of terrorism. They support terrorism. They produce terrorists. They fund terrorists. They support militancy all over the world. Pakistan harbors terrorism. So we are here to tell the people of Jammu and Kashmir that we stand for you.
A protest was also held in Geneva on the sidelines of the recent UNHRC session, blaming Pakistan for blatant human rights violations and its unwavering support to terrorists. Activists said that those who were exposing Pakistan were not safe even in Europe, America or anywhere in the world, as Pakistani agency ISI was constantly following them.
Last year, prominent activist Kariba Baloch and journalist Sajid Hussain were found murdered under suspicious circumstances.
And they are always trying to suppress the voices of diaspora, Sindhis, Balochis, Pashtuns, and the Kashmiris, who actually expose internationally the real face of Pakistan. If they think that they will stop us, or they will stop our voice, this voice that never stop. Our voice will raise more and more.
Crushing dissent with brute high-handedness has become a norm in Pakistan. And with the press acting as a tool to further state propaganda, all crimes have either been whitewashed, appropriated, or have been given an entirely opposite spin. These victims, however, feel that one day their sustained efforts will pay off and they will gain their rights or complete freedom from Pakistani rule.
Moving on, it's been weeks since the Taliban swept to power in Kabul and promised a better life to Afghans under their rule. However, the situation in the war-torn country is getting grimmer by the day. While unavailable women rights in the Taliban regime have triggered a debate, it is the health and economy sectors that are bearing the major brunt. People have not just grown homeless and unemployed, but they are becoming increasingly vulnerable to more diseases apart from the pandemic. Commoners are appealing the world and the local doctors and authorities to empathize and help them in this unfolding crisis.
Since taking power, the Taliban have grappled with a severe economic crisis and have faced pressure on issues ranging from girls' education to allegations of reprisal against former officials and others associated with the previous government. However, amid all this, the common Afghans are suffering at all fronts as the world has still not recognized the Taliban and the cash flow has been barricaded, which has only worsened the condition of Afghans, especially those requiring medical attention or major surgeries. The World Health Organization's representative to Afghanistan had earlier called on the international community to resume funding of the war-torn country's health program, which was suspended when the Taliban took over governing the country, as the healthcare system had plunged into crisis. No development has been seen in this issue so far. Problems multiplied when several of the resident doctors fled owing to Taliban's fears and others left the profession altogether. Even the supporters of the Taliban say they had hoped better, but it is turning out to be a major crisis. The observations made by the UN team that visited Afghanistan recently have rung bells for both the Afghan health system and the international community. Only 17% of all Sehatmandi health facilities are now fully functional. This breakdown in health services is having a rippling effect on the availability of basic and essential health care, as well as on emergency response, polio eradication, and COVID-19 vaccination efforts. 9 of 37 COVID-19 hospitals have already closed, and all aspects of the COVID-19 response have dropped, including surveillance, testing, and vaccination. Prior to August this year, 2.2 million people had been vaccinated against COVID-19. In recent weeks, vaccination rates have decreased rapidly, while 1.8 million COVID-19 vaccine doses in the country remain unused. Swift action is needed to use these doses in the coming weeks and work towards reaching the goal of vaccinating at least 20% of the population by the end of the year based on national targets. People on the other side say that they are unable to afford even the limited health facilities as the economy too has been crushed severely.
چونکی در افغانستان فعلاً غریبی نیست، مردم بیکار است، در بدر است، دکترها فیش چپایان بیاره، برای مشکلات مردم رسیدگی شود.
In the World Health Organization's words, Afghanistan's health system is on the brink of collapse. And if an urgent action is not taken, the country faces an imminent humanitarian catastrophe. The world body has reiterated its long-term commitment to advancing the health of all Afghans and has urged international stakeholders to come up front to assist Afghans, but nothing of that sort is converting into actions thus far. In the meantime, the Afghans can only wait, pray, and hope.
And now in our section of Asia This Week, the stories from across the continent that hit the headlines this week.
India and Nepal recently held a joint project monitoring committee meeting on post-earthquake reconstruction projects in the Himalayan nation. During the meeting in Kathmandu, a comprehensive review of the progress of the Indian government-assisted post-earthquake reconstruction projects in housing, education, health and cultural heritage sectors in Nepal was carried out, said the statement issued by the Indian Embassy in Kathmandu. Both sides expressed satisfaction with the successful completion of 50,000 houses in Gorkha and Nuwakot districts of Nepal constructed under the Government of India's assistance in the housing sector. Similarly, both sides also noted with appreciation the progress achieved in reconstruction projects being undertaken under education, cultural heritage and health sectors in Nepal. The meeting was co-chaired by Anurag Srivastava, Joint Secretary of Ministry of External Affairs of India, and Sushil Chandra Tiwari, Secretary, National Reconstruction Authority of India. As per the release, the JPMC mechanism was set up in August 2017 to monitor the Government of India-assisted post-earthquake reconstruction projects in Nepal. The meeting was attended by representatives of concerned ministries, department and agencies of Government of Nepal, officers and officials of Government of India, consultants and other stakeholders engaged in the implementation of the projects.
Tokyo Station is the entry point for visitors. The Marunouchi Station building was constructed in Tokyo as a symbol of Japan's modernization and developed along with Japan's representative business district. Its long history witnessed many historical events. In 2012, Tokyo Station, an important national cultural property, was rebuilt to its original appearance. The interior of the dome has been built with gypsum with the latest architectural technology. Many tourists visit the square to take pictures with the backdrop of Tokyo Station. Recently, wedding photos have been increasing as visitors are spellbound with the beauty of the Tokyo Station. Tokyo Station has been loved by all generations and is attracting attention as a tourist destination around the world. Otemachi and Marunouchi in Tokyo are representative business towns. At lunchtime, hungry business workers go out for lunch. Food trucks are lined up in building squares and park. The food truck business has been active in Japan for several years. These days, popular dishes include Vietnamese sandwiches, Asian chicken rice, and charcoal grilled fish. In order to attract customers, the restaurant offers trendy dishes.
Umiuroshi chicken bento. Bento, yes. So, there are many types of bento.
Food truck place is in public parks and building square where there are benches and tables available for eating. It is a Japanese noodle food truck popular among foreign tourists. In this truck, special containers are used to make it easy to carry around. It feels like a luxurious food truck, and this traditional Japanese dish that is dipped in sweet sauce and grilled over charcoal. The popularity of food trucks in Japan is giving new hope to restaurant industry amid COVID-19.
Moving on, the most distinctive features of India are its rivers. Rivers are considered sacred and are worshipped in the country. A number of festivals and rituals are held by the ghats of rivers. River Ganga witnesses the most of them. Recently, devotees gathered along the river's banks in different cities to mark the Pitrupaksh or the ancestors' fortnight. The ritual, as per the Hindu belief, is held for the well-being of their ancestors' spirits. Have a look.
Wearing white dhotis and carrying towels, also called gamchas, on their shoulders, devotees thronged various banks of River Ganga in northern Varanasi and Gaya cities to perform rituals and prayed for the well-being of their ancestors' soul during the ongoing Pitrupaksh or fortnight of ancestors. Pitrupaksh is a way for people to express gratitude towards their parents and ancestors for having helped them to be what they are and praying for their peace. It is believed that certain rituals performed during this period, which is also called Shraddh, appease the souls of the ancestors and bring happiness and prosperity at home. Usually, the rituals of Pitrupaksh are performed between a 15-day period. According to the Hindu tradition, Pitrupaksh falls on the Hindu lunar month of Bhadrapada, beginning with the full moon day.
16 दिन का जो है तिथि होता है इसमें जो है पितर लोग इस समय धरती पे आते हैं निवास करते हैं तो इस समय पितर पक्ष में जो भी श्राद्ध तर्पण त्रिपिंडी श्राद्ध का विशेष महत्व है इसमें
This year too, special food items were offered to ancestors by their family members as they performed rituals and took part in the traditional Tripindi Shraddh to free their souls of any evil spirit. Devotees prepared dumpling-shaped pins and kept them at river banks as offerings to their ancestors. Some also got their heads tonsured on the occasion as a mark of respect for them. People also take a pledge to observe a one-day silent fast by not uttering a word throughout the day when they perform pint dan.
Aaj Sangam Prayagraj mein aaye hain Allahabad Pita ji ke pint dan karne tithi thi aaj purnamasi ka din hai.
It is believed that when humans die, their mortal body turns to dust, whereas the soul remains until it does not find another mortal body to reside. The cycle of rebirth can cease and the soul can receive salvation if these sacred rituals are performed, the Hindus contend.
Such rituals in Hindu religion depict the rich cultural history of India, where belief can part a river, move mountains, and endure the sufferings. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.
Subscribe TAG TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.